Module 2, Phase Controlled Converters. Here we will be studying control techniques, single phase half wave and a full wave controlled rectifier with R load and RL load and along with the freewheeling diode. So this support the first part of the module 2, that is phase controlled converter. And the second part of the module 2 is chopper, where we are studying about the classification of chopper, basic operation of a chopper, step down and a step up chopper, and both up and down choppers. So we start the first part of the module 2, that is phase controlled converter. So here, before studying the phase controlled converters, we need to understand what is rectifier and the classification of a rectifier. We already studied in our basic electronics that a rectifier is a device which converts AC to DC. So that process we call it as a rectification. Rectification is a process of converting an alternating current or a voltage into a direct current or voltage. That process we call it as a rectification. So these rectifiers, based on the equipment which is used for in the rectification process, the rectifiers are classified as uncontrolled rectifier, fully controlled rectifier, and half controlled rectifier. That is mentioned in the three columns: uncontrolled rectifier, fully controlled rectifier, and half controlled rectifier. So these classification are made based on the semiconductor device which is used for the rectification process. If only diode is used in the rectifier, so that type of a rectification we call it as a uncontrolled rectifier. So that is first one, uncontrolled rectifier. Only we are using a diode. So if we use a diode and a thyristor, we call it as a half controlled rectifier. If we use only thyristor, we call it as a fully controlled rectifier. So if only diode is used, as name says, it's an uncontrolled device, where it is a unidirectional device where controlling operation is not possible. So for that reason, we call it as a uncontrolled rectifier. So if a diode along with the thyristor we are using, that we call it as a half controlled rectifier. So if only thyristor is used in the rectification process, that we call it as a fully controlled rectifier. This is about the main classification based on the components which are used in the rectification process. Then one more thing here is, if a power flows from input to output, usually, as name says, rectification, the power is AC and the output is DC. That has to flow from AC to DC. That's a conversion. If a power flow is from AC to DC, that we call it as only AC to DC. That is a unidirectional device. If power is flowing from AC to DC, so that process is a unidirectional. So that process we call it as a unidirectional process. So that type of a converter, only they convert a AC to DC. So that process we call it as a unidirectional process. So that process is possible in only in diodes as well as in half controlled rectifier. Uncontrolled and half controlled rectifiers are unidirectional converters. That is, power is flowing from AC to DC, that is input to output. Sometimes, so if a arrangement is made in such a way that the power is flowing from in AC to DC as well as DC to AC, so two-way power flow is possible. So that type of a power flow converters we call it as a bidirectional converters. The bidirectional converters are nothing but where they are using a thyristors. So that is fully controlled rectifier. Here, as thyristors are used, the output can be controlled with the help of a firing angle. So that is possible. So output variation is possible, that is by varying the firing angle. So here also, in a half controlled rectifier, diode as well as a thyristor is present. So the output can be controlled with the help of the firing angle. So but diode is present, so that's why we call it as a unidirectional converter. This is about the classification of rectification process based on the devices used and based on the power flow. So along with that devices used in a rectification process, so there is a one more based on the output voltage and current. So this classification is based on the type of semiconductor device and power flow. So another classification of this rectifier is based on the output voltage, whether we are getting the output voltage in a first quadrant, second quadrant, third quadrant and fourth quadrant. Based on that, based on the polarity of the output voltage, we are going to classify the rectifiers as one quadrant converters, two quadrant converters and four quadrant converters. As name says, one quadrant converters. In this one quadrant converters, so that is voltage is also positive and the current is also positive. If in this is a rectification box, if the rectifier consists of a diode, one diode and one SCR, then output voltage and current is the connection is made in such a way that the output voltage and the current which is obtained after this conversion is positive. Both are positive. That is first quadrant that acts like a rectifier. That is a first quadrant operation. And the second one is, if only a thyristor is used and the thyristor is connected in such a way that voltage, the output voltage is at the output side, is we are getting both positive as well as a negative. That is, output voltage available at the output side after conversion process, that is both positive as well as a negative, and the current is only positive, that you can see over here in the first quadrant and in fourth quadrant. So current is positive and voltage is both positive as well as a negative. In such a way, they are connecting the SCR. So that type of operation we call it as a true quadrant converter. In the first quadrant, it acts like a rectifier. In the fourth quadrant, it acts like a inverter. And if two thyristors are connected, that the converter 1 and a converter 2. So this we call it as a converter. So if a two thyristors are used and they are connected in such a way that output voltage as well as output current is available in both direction. So here we are getting a positive voltage as well as a negative voltage, positive current as well as a negative current. So in both direction we are getting a output voltage and current. That is, it is operating in all four quadrant. In first quadrant it acts like a rectifier, in fourth quadrant it acts like a inverter, in second quadrant it acts like a inverter, and in third quadrant it acts like a rectifier. So that you have to mention. So in which quadrant it what operation it performs. So if only one diode and one SCR is used, that is a one quadrant operation. If only one SCR is used, that is two quadrant operation. If two SCRs are used, then it is a four quadrant converters. That is the thyristor family. We have a different components in thyristor family. So that is two thyristors and one thyristors. So this is about the different classification based on the output voltage and output current, as well as here based on the type of a device which is used for the rectification process, and power flow based on the power flow. If it is power is flowing from input to output, that is a unidirectional. If a power is flowing in the both direction, that is a bidirectional. This is about the rectifiers. The next topic is control techniques. Here I forgot to mention it, the heading control techniques. The topic name is control techniques. In control techniques, there are three types how we are going to control the output voltage. The first one is phase angle control, and the second one is extension angle control, and third one is pulse width modulation control. We'll see one by one. So the first one is phase angle control. As you can see the waveform, by varying the pulse, that's a firing pulse, the phase angle control is nothing but a based on the, this is also called as a firing angle control. So by varying the firing angle of a SCR, or by varying the other semiconductor device, we can control the output voltage. Phase angle control, this is also called as a firing angle control. So here, as name says, firing angle control, by varying the firing angle of a thyristor, we are going to control the output voltage. So as you can see here, this is the supply voltage and this is the output voltage, this is the output voltage and this is the firing angle which we are giving to SCR as well as GTO or GDO. And if we don't want to use a SCR, the other family of a thyristor, that is a MOSFET and IGBT, can also be used for controlling the output voltage, that is shown over here. Either we can use this one, or else this one. The advantage of this using this SCR is more compared to the MOSFET and IGBT. So for that reason, we are not using MOSFET and IGBT. The advantage is more that we see now. So as you can see over here, there are two terms, alpha as well as the delta. Here alpha is the delta is the width of the firing pulse. So width of this firing particular pulse and alpha is the firing angle. Suppose here if we give the firing pulse for the SCR, then only the switch is closed. Then the input voltage will be available at the output voltage. This is the output voltage that we are getting. So that is for a SCR. Suppose if we are not using the SCR, so assume we are using a MOSFET and IGBT. In that case, we need to apply the firing pulse in such a way that the starting of the pulse we have to give as well as the end point of the pulse also we need to give. That is the length of this, that is a delta. The length of the firing angle is more if we are not using the SCR. So here you can see the delta, that is nothing but the width of the firing angle. Here it is less compared to this one if you are using a MOSFET as well as IGBT. So here power loss is more, here power loss is less. So here the on pulse as well as the off pulse, that is the on as well as the off pulse we need to give. But here only the triggering pulse if we apply, then SCR will turn on, that is the switch is closed, the input will be available, that is we are getting the voltage at the output side. So as soon as the SCR reaches anode current reaches to zero and when the negative cycle starts, the automatically SCR will turn off. So in this period there is no output voltage. So again, if we apply the same pulse, then only it will turn on. When the switch is closed, then only we are getting the output voltage. This is the output voltage which is available at the load side. So these are the firing pulses. Suppose control, how we are going to control by varying this firing pulse here is, if you are using a SCR, if I supply the firing pulse over here, means we will be getting the voltage at this point only. Here in this entire period, the SCR is off. If the SCR is off, means there is no output at the load side. So that by varying this firing angle position, we can vary the output voltage. So but if you are using a MOSFET as well as IGBT, then power loss is more compared to this one. You can see by seeing this length, the delta length which is at SCR as well as the delta length at MOSFET and IGBT. Here on pulse as well as off pulse we have to give, then only the device will turn off. But here we need to give the on pulse for the SCR. Automatically it will turn off at 0 point, and again the cycle repeats for the positive half cycle, the same thing. But here the length of the firing angle is more, so power loss is more over here. This is one method of controlling the output voltage, that is phase angle control. The another method of control technique of a converter is extension angle control. Here there are two methods of controlling extension angle control. This is our input supply and this is output voltage. So till here we are getting the output voltage, till here. So the input voltage is available at the output side, so till here. So when we apply the pulse triggered switch, when this pulse is applied, that is a rising edge of this pulse, when this pulse is applied, what happens? The output will be 0. This is one method of pulse triggers which of controlling the output voltage. So this length we call it as a beta. So that beta is nothing but an extension angle control. Here we will be using an inductor, that is an energy storing device. We will study in detail about the this extension angle in R as well as R control technique of a phase controlled converters. That we will study in detail. Now in this extension angle control, you just need to remember, when we are using a pulse triggered switch, so the rising edge of pulse acts like a off period for the load. So that is, when this rising pulse is applied, when this pulse is raised, at that time we are getting the output voltage 0. That is, here it will stop conducting, that you can see over here. When the rising edge of this pulse is applied, at that time the output voltage is 0. So this is one method of pulse triggered switch. So this entire period is 0. In negative half cycle it won't conduct. So again, in the positive half cycle, when the pulse, this pulse is applied, so at that time the output voltage is 0. Exactly opposite to this phase controlled converter. When a gate pulse is applied, it will start to conduct. But here, when a pulse is applied, the output voltage is 0. That is one way of controlling the output voltage, that is pulse triggered switch, by using this pulse triggered switch. And another method is level triggered switch. So here in a level triggered switch, what they are doing, so here till here, where when the falling edge of this control voltage occurs, so when this control voltage is available, then we are getting the output voltage. The second one is level triggered switch. In a level triggered switch, what is happening? So when we want the output voltage, during that time we are applying the control voltage. When we don't want the output voltage, at that time, that is a falling edge of this control voltage acts like a off for the particular load. So till here it won't conduct, till here it will be conducting. So when this falling edge occurs, at that time the output voltage is 0. That is one method. Either we can use a pulse triggered or a level trigger. During pulse triggered switch, the rising edge of the pulse acts like a off, that is a open for the particular switch. Here the falling edge of this control voltage acts like a off for this load voltage. So this is about the pulse triggered switch and level triggered switch. Here we will be using an energy storing device. So in detail we study about the energy storing device in R as well as RL load of phase control rectifier, fully and half control rectifier. So this is pulse, that is the extension angle control method. So this angle we call it as a beta. So that is nothing but a extension angle. The third one is a pulse width modulation control. Here, the next method is pulse width modulation control. Here, this is our input and this is our output voltage. Here, in this method of pulse width modulation control, it depends upon the firing angle as well as the width of the pulse also. That is the alpha. It depends upon the alpha as well as the delta. So this is the width of the pulse. So as you can see here, the level triggered pulse here, the rising edge of the pulse acts like a close of the particular switch. Then this is the output voltage. Here the device is conducting. The output voltage is available at the load side. That is the falling edge of this pulse, that is a level triggered pulse, acts like a off for the, that is on for the particular switch. The switch will be open. At that time we are not getting the output voltage. Till here, till the width of this particular pulse, the output voltage is available. This is one method. That is, based on the width of this pulse, we are controlling the output voltage. This rising edge of this pulse acts like a close for the particular switch. Then we are getting the output voltage. This input voltage will be available at the output side. The falling edge of this pulse acts like a open for the particular switch. At that time, there is no output voltage. Till here, we are getting the output voltage. So here, the output voltage depends upon this firing angle alpha, that is where we are rising the particular pulse, as well as the width of this particular pulse, that is delta, the width of this applied pulse. It depends upon both. By varying this width of the particular pulse, we can vary the output voltage. Either if we give the pulse only this much, means we will be getting the output voltage only for this length. If we are applying the pulse for the entire length, means we will be getting the output voltage at the for the entire width of that particular pulse. So here it depends upon both the firing angle alpha as well as the width of the particular pulse. Here that is one more thing, that is a pi by 2 minus delta by 2. So why it is mentioned over here is, if this is a delta, is the length of this entire particular width of the entire pulse, then here we have a 90 degree, that is pi by 2, 90 degree. So this part we can call it as a delta by 2, no? This part we can call it as a delta by 2, and this as a delta by 2. If I divide the entire length delta equal to two parts, so this part of the particular pulse we call it as a pi by 2 minus delta by 2. So this part we call it as a, at this point is nothing but a pi by 2, 90 degree. Pi by 2 plus delta by 2. That's why it is mentioned. So the rising point, that is the rising point of pulse, is at pi by 2 minus delta by 2, and the falling edge of this entire this width of this pulse is at pi by 2 plus delta by 2. So the delta by 2 is based on this width. So exactly we are dividing. So this part we call it as a delta by 2, and this part we call it as a delta by 2. And this middle portion is exactly at 90 degree, no? That is nothing but a pi by 2. So pi by 2 plus delta by 2, pi by 2 minus delta by 2. So the rising edge is at pi by 2 minus delta by 2, and the falling edge of this pulse is at pi by 2 plus delta by 2. So it depends upon both firing angle where we are rising the pulse, as well as the width of the particular pulse. So this is one method. Another method is by using the pulses. So if we are not using this one, means we can use the pulses. So if we are using pulses, means we need to use a two pulse, the rising pulse as well as a falling pulse. So this is a turn on pulse and a turn off pulse. So when the pulse is applied, when the falling, that is a rising edge of the pulse is encountered, at that time the output voltage is available. The switch will be closed, and the we are getting the input voltage at the output side. This is input, and we are getting at output when this pulse is applied, rising edge of the pulse. Similarly, if we want to control the output voltage, there should be a limit. No, here we are not using any controlled SCR. We are not using, automatically it will not turn off during negative half cycle. We need to turn off the device. We need to control the output voltage at the positive half cycle, means we need to use one more pulse. So here, if we apply one more pulse, this rising edge acts like a open for the particular switch. So this, only for this duration we will be getting the output voltage. So this pulse acts like a on for the particular device, and another pulse acts like a off for particular device. So in this point, when we apply the pulse, that is the rising edge of the pulse will be getting the output voltage, and one more pulse if we apply, so that acts like a off for the particular device. So two pulses we need to use. So pulse is different, and the SCR firing angle is different. So we need to use a two pulses, one for oning and one for off. So this is about a pulse width modulation. So either we can use a level triggered voltage, as well as a pulses, that is two pulses we need to use to control the output voltage.